Hi, my name is Sanjay Gupta. I'm a consultant cardiologist, and this is More Than Just Medicine. Today, I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about atrial fibrillation, particularly what its consequences are. The first thing to say is that any medical condition can only do two things to a patient, okay? It can shorten the patient's lifespan, and it can affect the patient's quality of life. So atrial fibrillation, again, in terms of lifespan, and the big risk with a condition like atrial fibrillation is the risk of causing strokes. Atrial fibrillation can cause strokes, okay? And I'll explain to you why that happens. Imagine what happens when you develop atrial fibrillation. 15%, the top chamber of the heart, the top chambers of the heart stop working. The 15 oarsmen of the boat stop working, so the heart is being the main pumping is done by the ventricles or the 85 guys at the bottom. And therefore, when you're in atrial fibrillation, you're only pumping out around about 85% of the blood that you would ordinarily. And because 85% of the blood is being pumped out, 15% remains within the heart, and therefore 15% of the blood does not move as much as the other 85%. And because it does not move as much, it can stagnate. And when it stagnates, it can form a blood clot. And then there is a theoretical risk that bits of that blood clot can get dislodged and go to the brain and cause strokes. So atrial fibrillation can be associated with strokes. And this is the main thing. This is the main risk in terms of prognosis or length of life is from atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation does not cause you to suddenly drop down dead. It doesn't cause people to have heart attacks in general, but it can cause strokes. The risk of stroke can be quantified, and that is done using a scoring system called the CHADS-2-VASc scoring system. Okay. So CHADS-2-VASc, if you look it up on the internet, but what it refers to is a series of risk factors. And if the patient has those risk factors, then their risk of a stroke from their atrial fibrillation is higher. So the risk factors, C stands for congestive heart failure. So if you have a weak heart to start off with, so if you've already got a weak heart and then you lose 15 additional percent, there's a lot more blood that is going to stagnate, and therefore you'll more likely that you'll form a clot, and therefore more likely to have a stroke. Number two, H stands for hypertension, high blood pressure. So if you have high blood pressure, that adds a risk factor to the risk of stroke. A stands for age. If you are above the age of 65, you get a point. And if you're above the age of 75, you get 2 points. So the older you are, the greater the risk of having strokes. But the risk starts going up after the age of 65. D stands for diabetes. So if you're diabetic, you're at more likelihood of having strokes. S2 means if you've had a previous stroke or a mini stroke, TIA. In that case, you get 2 points, okay? It increases your risk substantially. Then there is VASc, which means that if you have any evidence of vascular disease, then you get a point as well. And then there's also gender, i.e. if you're female, you get a point. And most people would say that if you are male and you score more than 1 point, then your risks of having a stroke are substantial, but they go up exponentially if you have more of those risk factors, i.e. hypertension, high blood pressure, diabetes, previous strokes, if you're above the age of 65, if you've got heart failure, if you've got any sort of vascular disease. By vascular disease, I mean if you've got stents in your heart, or if you've had bypasses of your legs or your heart, then that tells us you've got vascular disease and you're at a higher risk. So if you have any of those things, your risks of stroke are considered high enough to justify having something done about them. Now, what can you do about them to try and reduce the risk of strokes? Well, you can go on medications known as anticoagulants. And what anticoagulants do is that they work by stopping the blood from clotting when it would ordinarily clot. Okay, and by doing so, you don't form a clot, and because you don't form a clot, therefore you don't dislodge the clot, and therefore your risks of stroke go down substantially. It is thought that by going on an anticoagulant, you can reduce your risk of strokes from atrial fibrillation by up to 64%. Now, most people think, well, what is an anticoagulant? Well, there are medications which stop the blood from clotting normally. In the old days, aspirin used to be considered an anticoagulant. It isn't anymore, and most people would now argue, and in fact, virtually everyone now says that aspirin has no role in preventing strokes in atrial fibrillation. So when you're talking about an anticoagulant, the choices are warfarin, which is a tried and tested, very cheap agent, which is very effective, but has lots of inconveniences associated with it. And now you have more advanced agents called the NOACs, okay? And they do the same job as warfarin. And I will explain these to you in another video. But as long as, so the first thing, the summary in this video is, in terms of length of life, in terms of your lifespan, having atrial fibrillation can increase your risk of strokes. The risk goes up with age, and therefore the risk can only ever go up because you can only ever grow older. Once you score more than 1 point if you're a man, and more than and two or more points if you're a woman, then it is certainly in your interest to consider being on anticoagulants long term. All right, once you go on an anticoagulant, if your risk is high enough, it is generally felt that it is best that you stay on that anticoagulant for life, because as I say, the risk can only ever go up. Okay, in my next video, I'm going to talk about how atrial fibrillation can affect your quality of life. All right, thank you so much.